No writer's work, I don't think, can ever really be separated from his or her life. But in the case of Scholastique Mukasonga, the connection is particularly intense and particularly rich. It is a very hard life. Born Tutsi in a Rwanda dominated by an increasingly belligerent and militant Hutu majority, she knew persecution from her earliest childhood when she and her family were displaced from their homeland to a region of Rwanda so desolate that they didn't consider it to be Rwanda at all. She knew that same persecution throughout her youth. After a childhood of continual harassment by official and unofficial Hutu forces, she was accepted into the prestigious École d'Assistance Sociale in Butare, only to be driven from it 2 years later in a fresh outbreak of Hutu terrorism. She then knew the pain of being sent by her parents to Burundi at the age of 16 so that someone in the family would survive the calamity everyone suspected was coming. And then, as an adult, she knew the torment of surviving, of being thousands of miles away in France, comfortably settled and married, while virtually her entire extended family was being slaughtered. And then the pain of being unable to bring herself to go back. And then finally the pain of going back and facing the magnitude of the disaster. That harrowing, multi-layered story of loss and sorrow is, of course, one of the foundations of her work. It was long after the genocide of 1994 that she began to write. Her first book, Inyenzi Ule Kafar, which I've translated as Cockroaches, appeared in 2006, 12 years after. But throughout the works she's published in the past 10 years, that genocide is always present, even if the nature of those works has changed from the memoir in her first books, Cockroaches, and La Femme aux Pieds Nus, a very moving portrait of her mother, which I hope to make my next translation project, to a poetic evocation of her homeland and its tales, both legendary and historical, in her beautiful short story collections, Ligifu and Suka Mumiole Colline. To pure fiction, semi-autobiographical in the case of Notre-Dame du Nil, and then not at all autobiographical in her most recent book, The Sweeping Cœur d'Ambourg. Her writing has evolved then from the personal to the global, from memoir to epic, but has always remained rooted in the loss that is her heritage, even as that loss produces a body of work ever more diverse and complex. But there's another way in which her work is intertwined with her past, one that I want to emphasize here. The persecution of the Tutsis took a great many forms, but one of the most persistent is an erasure and a silencing. There are, of course, many ways to silence someone. You can kill them, you can wipe out every trace of their existence, but there are subtler ways too. You can sideline them, you can maintain them in a state of constant terror, you can hobble their efforts to educate themselves. That silencing is another aspect of Scholastique's heritage, and her writing can be seen as a fierce refusal to submit, to say everything her persecutors wanted to erase, and to speak in the very way that they wanted to make impossible. The acts of memory that are her early books are also acts of defiance. And so is everything that follows. For one whose early life is in such large part a story of silencing, to speak, to write, to create beauty is as important a task as to remember. And this brings us to what made me first fall in love with Scholastique's writing, her lovely, indelible narrative voice. I first encountered it a few years ago reading Notre-Dame du Nil, and long after I closed that book, long after its story went where stories go in our memories, that voice stayed with me, precise, sincere, somewhat reserved, very decent, clear, fearless. It was that voice that made me want to translate her work. If you look at the reader's reactions to Cockroaches on Goodreads, for example, you'll find that more than a few express a certain discomfort at rating and judging a book as raw and painful as this. I understand that reaction, but I also think it's the wrong reaction. If that pain can be transformed into beauty, if we can be moved by it, then that's a cause for joy and not for shame. Writing, she once said in an interview, is for her a song and a liberation, and it's worth carefully noting those two words, those two opposites of silence. Even in her bleakest stories, like Cockroaches, that sense of song and liberation comes through. The voice there is as plain-spoken as it is quietly poetic, as vital as it is despairing, sometimes inexpressibly sad, but too beautiful to express only sadness, and too alive to speak only of death. A paper grave, she calls this book, the only grave that her family will ever have. A haunting expression, but to my ear, this book is more than a grave. Thanks to her inimitable voice, there's too much life in these pages for them to be simply that. That's what I hear in Cockroaches, at least. And I can only hope that my translation captures it just a little. Tonight, we'll see, perhaps. Scholastique and I have chosen to read three passages from Cockroaches. The first is a scene from her childhood. The second, an account of her heart-wrenching separation from her parents. And then in the third, from the book's final pages, we see her return to the lost place that was once her home. Scholastique will read in French, and then I'll follow in English. Please welcome me and join me then in welcoming Scholastique Mukasonga. Oh, this one? Yep.
Bonsoir tout le monde. Merci de nous avoir donné ces quelques minutes. Les jours de Gitagata, c'est de mon enfance, et ni tant qu'ils furent des jours de malheur et de tristesse. Et puis, c'est étrangement calme où nos bourreaux semblaient nous avoir oubliés, les jours si peu nombreux d'une enfance ordinaire. Les journées à Gitagata commençaient avant l'aube. C'était ma mère qui se levait la première. Elle se lavait les pieds dans la rosée toute fraîche, puis elle allait frapper à la porte des voisins. C'était elle qui réveillait tout le village. Mon père Louis se chargeait d'enlever les nattes qui nous servaient de couverture en criant « Henouka, Henouka !» Debout, et on sautait du lit. Il y avait beaucoup de choses à faire avant de partir à l'école. Chercher de l'eau, balayer la maison et la cour. Alexia et moi, nous nous partagions les tâches. Au début, nous nous partagions aussi le pagne de ma mère. C'était le seul pagne que nous possédions à la maison. Puis ma mère, qui savait coudre, nous confectionnait une robe. Mais nous n'avions toujours qu'une seule robe, Alexia et moi. Aussi, un jour, c'était Alexia qui allait à l'école avec la robe, et le lendemain, c'était moi. Je cédais volontiers mon tour de robe à ma grande sœur et préférais de beaucoup rester avec ma mère. Pendant ce temps, mon père, Louis, avait noué son petit pagne blanc. Il partait à la messe. Chaque jour, il allait à la messe. Pour le déjeuner, ma mère me réservait quelques patates douces qu'elle enveloppait dans des feuilles de bananier et je partais en courant. À partir de la troisième année primaire, on allait à la grande école à Nyamata. J'y allais en courant. En courant, je saluais les femmes qui balayaient le petit sentier qui menait jusqu'à leur maison. En courant, j'appelais les copines pour savoir si elles étaient déjà parties. Candida et elle m'attendaient sur le bord de la piste. En courant, j'arrivais à l'école, je déposais ma petite provision de patates douces au fond de la classe et je me précipitais derrière les bâtiments de l'école où les filles jouaient à la marelle. Les garçons, eux, occupaient la cour. Ils jonglaient des pieds avec les ballons en feuilles de bananier. Il n'était pas question d'y aller. La rentrée de chaque matin me paraissait une cérémonie grandiose et compliquée. Le tambour battait. Tous les élèves se regroupaient dans la cour, bien en rang, classe par classe. On hissait le drapeau pendant qu'on chantait l'hymne national. Sur un nouveau battement de tambour, chacun se dirigeait vers sa classe et s'alignait, les plus petits devant, les plus grands derrière, une file de garçons, une file de filles. Dans l'encadrement de la porte, le maître nous fixait son bateau derrière le dos. Le tambour donnait le signal de rentrer en classe. On restait debout tandis que le maître, son bateau à la main, traversait lentement la salle. Nous lui disions en chœur « Bonjour, maître !» Lorsqu'il arrivait devant le tableau, il faisait signe au chouchou d'entonner la prière que toute la classe reprenait. On pouvait en fait s'asseoir et la leçon commençait. Marie et retardataire s'il osait encore se présenter. Le bateau du maître ne connaissait aucune excuse. Il y avait pourtant une excuse qui était admise aussi bien par l'instituteur que par les parents, la rencontre des éléphants. Souvent, en effet, des éléphants traversaient le village pour aller d'une étendue de brousse encore sauvage à une autre. Parfois, l'un d'eux, on ne sait pourquoi, suivait la route. Les parents nous avaient dit, surtout, restez derrière l'éléphant. Ne dépassez jamais l'éléphant. Ne vous mettez jamais devant lui. On suivait donc l'animal qui avançait majestueusement comme en flânant. Les Rwandais ont toujours admiré la démarche de l'éléphant, qu'ils considèrent comme gracieuse et élégante, et les femmes dans les danses font l'éloge du noble pachyderme. Nous suivions scrupuleusement les conseils de nos parents, marchant derrière l'animal à bonne distance, respectant les haltes et ses détours. Quelquefois, la matinée passait avant que l'animal ne se décide à changer de direction. Ce n'était plus la peine d'aller à l'école. Mieux valait aller cueillir les amabongo. Nous étions sûrs que les parents ne diraient rien puisque nous avions suivi un éléphant. Les éléphants n'étaient pourtant pas le plus grand danger que les écoliers pouvaient rencontrer sur la route de Nyamata. Il y avait aussi la cruauté des hommes, mais de cela, je parlerai plus tard. Plus tard aussi, nous avons revu les éléphants. Ils étaient sur des camions. Je crois qu'on les transportait au parc de la Kagera. C'est à l'école que j'ai découvert qu'il y avait d'autres livres que la Bible. À la maison, il n'y avait que la Bible de mon père. Chaque matin, il la déposait sur l'étagère où auraient dû être rangés les objets les plus précieux de la maison. Les pots allaient, mais nous n'avions pas de vaches et donc pas de lait. À côté de la Bible, il y avait une bouteille de bénédictine, vide bien sûr. C'était aussi un objet vénéré. Mon père disait que c'était la boisson du roi. Le roi buvait de l'hydromel des blancs. Je pensais à part moi que cela lui avait peut-être porté malheur. Mais mon père était fier de sa bouteille. À l'école, le maître de temps en temps nous distribuait les livres qu'il gardait précieusement sur son bureau. Il y en avait un pour deux ou pour trois. Le livre s'appelait « Matin d'Afrique ». Mais l'Afrique dont il était question ici, ce n'était pas la nôtre. Pas celle en tout cas où se trouvait le Rwanda. Il y avait tant de choses étranges, des baobabs, des marigots. Les enfants s'appelaient Mamadou, Fatoumata. Fatoumata, disions-nous, mais ça n'existait pas. C'est Fortunata. Ça, c'est un vrai nom de fille. Le maître se fâchait. Fatoumata, disait-il. Répétez après moi. Fatoumata. Et sans être convaincu, nous répétions après lui. Fatoumata, Fatoumata. Pourtant, grâce à son livre, nous pressentions que le monde était plus vaste que nous pouvions l'imaginer. Et puis, il y avait de si belles histoires. Sidbad, le marin. Yawata et les canards sauvages, Monsieur Segué et sa chèvre, le lièvre et la tortue, et j'en passe. Je rêvais parfois l'impossible, avoir un livre pour moi toute seule.
Those days in Gitagata, the days of my childhood, so many were days of pain and sadness, and then others were strangely peaceful, as if our tormentors had forgotten us, ordinary childhood days, few and far between. Days in Gitagata began before dawn. My mother was always the first one up. She washed her feet in the fresh dew and then went to knock on the neighbors' doors. She was the one who woke up the whole village. Meanwhile, my father pulled away the mats we used as blankets, shouting, Hanuka, Hanuka, get up! And we jumped out of bed. There was much to be done before we went off to school, fetch water, sweep the house and the yard. Alexia and I shared the chores. In the early days, we also shared my mother's paña, it's a kind of garment. It was the only one we had in the house. Then my mother, who knew how to sew, made us a dress, but Alexia and I still had only one dress between us. And so one day it was Alexia who went to school with the dress, and the next day it was me. I happily gave up my turn with it because I vastly preferred staying home with my mother. Meanwhile, my father had tied on his little white paña. He was off to Mass. He went to Mass every day. My mother always set aside a few sweet potatoes for my lunch. She wrapped them up in banana leaves, and I ran off. Starting from the third year of primary school, we went to the big school in Yamada. I ran all the way there. As I ran, I said hello to the women sweeping the little paths in front of the houses. As I ran, I called out to my friends to see if they'd already set off. Candida would be waiting for me beside the dirt road. I ran all the way to the school, putting my little cache of sweet potatoes at the back of the classroom, and hurried around behind the school buildings where the girls were playing hopscotch. The boys had taken over the playground, juggling a banana leaf soccer ball with their feet. That was off limits to us. The start to the school day seemed to me a grandiose and elaborate ceremony. The drumbeat sounded. All the pupils gathered on the playground in neat rows by class. We sang the national anthem as the flag was raised. The drum sounded again, and we all headed off toward our classrooms and lined up, the smallest ones in front, the bigger ones behind, one line of boys, one line of girls. The teacher stood watching over us from the doorway, his stick behind his back. The drum gave the signal to enter the classrooms. We stayed on our feet as the teacher walked through the room, stick in hand. In chorus, we called out, "Good morning, teacher." Once he reached the blackboard, he signaled his pet to say the prayer, and the whole class prayed along. At last, we could sit down, and the lessons began. Woe unto any straggler who still dared to come in. The teacher's stick recognized no excuse. There was one excuse, though, that was accepted by teachers and parents alike, an encounter with elephants. Elephants often walk through the villages on the way from one remaining patch of wilderness to another. Sometimes, it's not clear why, one of them followed the road. Our parents had told us, whatever you do, stay behind the elephant, never pass him, never get in front of him. And so we followed behind as the animal majestically walked along, as if out for a stroll. Rwandans have always admired the elephant's walk, which they consider graceful and elegant. When women dance, they're paying homage to the noble pachyderm. We scrupulously followed our parents' instructions, keeping our distance from the animal, imitating its pauses and detours. Sometimes a whole morning went by before the elephants decided to turn away. There's no point to going to school now. Better to go looking for amabungo to pick. We knew our parents wouldn't say anything since we'd been following an elephant. Still, elephants weren't the greatest danger school children could meet with on the road to Niamata. There was also the cruelty of men, but I'll save that for later. Later, too, we saw the elephants again. They were on trucks. I think they were being moved to Akagera National Park. It was at school that I learned there were other books than the Bible. My father's Bible was the only book we had in our house. Every morning he laid it on the shelf that should have been taken up by milk jugs, a household's most precious possession, but we had no cows, and so no milk. Next to the Bible sat a bottle of Benedictine, empty, of course. That was also an object to be treated with reverence. My father said Benedictine was the drink of the king. The king drank the white people's nectar. I secretly thought that might have brought him misfortune, but my father was proud of his bottle. At school, the teacher had a neat stack of books on his desk, and sometimes he handed them out, one for every two or three of us. The book was called African Mornings, but the Africa we read about there wasn't our Africa, not the Africa where Rwanda was, at least. There were so many strange things, baobabs, oxbow lakes. The children were named Mamadou, Fatoumata. Fatoumata, we would say. There's no such thing as Fatoumata. It's Fortunata. That's a real girl's name. That would make the teacher angry. Fatoumata, he would say. Repeat after me, Fatoumata. And although we still had our doubts, we repeated after him, Fatoumata, Fatoumata. Nonetheless, thanks to that book, we sensed that the world was bigger than we could imagine. And there were such wonderful stories, Sinbad the Sailor, Hiawatha and the Wild Ducks, Mr. Surgan and his goat, the tortoise and the hare. Sometimes I dreamed of an impossible thing, having a book all to myself. The next passage is from the middle of the book, and this is about the moment when Scholastique and her brother were sent away by her parents to Burundi to escape what they saw as a genocide in the making.
Il ne nous restait plus qu'à partir. Au Burundi, nous aurions sans doute une chance de continuer nos études, de trouver du travail. Et surtout, les parents ne savaient comment le dire. Il fallait au moins que quelques-uns survivent, gardent de la mémoire, que la famille ailleurs puisse continuer. Nous avions été choisis pour survivre. Pour nous guider jusqu'à la frontière, on comptait sur Antoine, mon frère aîné. Il travaillait à l'Institut agronomique de Karama comme jardinier. Il ne rentrait à la maison que le samedi soir. Il y faisait la route à vélo. Ce samedi-là, nous nous sommes réunis autour de la cruche de sorgho que ma mère préparait toujours pour le retour de son fils aîné. Antoine nous dit qu'il connaissait mal la brousse. Avec son vélo, il se contentait de suivre les pistes, mais son ami Frodoir, dont j'ai déjà parlé, qui était employé au projet d'éradication de la mouche tsetse, lui était tout indiqué pour nous faire passer au Burundi. Frodoir, c'était comme son frère. Il était sûr qu'il ne refuserait pas. Et en effet, Frodoir accepta. Le jour fixé pour le départ arriva bien vite. On devait s'en aller au bon milieu de la nuit. Lorsqu'on serait sûr que tout le voisinage serait bien endormi. Ce n'est pas que nous craignions d'être dénoncés, mais si les voisins nous voyaient partir, beaucoup voudraient se joindre à nous. Partir en groupe, c'était impossible. On risquait d'être vite repéré par les patrouilles des militaires d'Ogako et on pouvait craindre des représailles pour ceux qui restaient. Dès que les voisins sont rentrés chez eux, on a fermé la porte et fait semblant de dormir. Frodoir est arrivé. Mon père disait le chapelet, il faisait le tour de la bananerie derrière la maison en égrenant des « Je vous salue Marie ». Ma mère, qui d'habitude refusait de se joindre à la procession, pour une fois le suivait. Moi aussi, je crois que je l'ai suivi. Elle était venue de partir. Il fallait arriver à la frontière avant le lever du jour. Frodoir avait dit qu'il faudrait marcher vite. Ce n'était pas les bagages qui allaient nous encombrer. André, mon frère, outre le petit sac de toile qui contenait sa chemise et son short, portait contre lui ses deux trésors. Son diplôme, qu'il avait soigneusement roulé dans un étui en plastique, et le lecteur de cassette. Moi, je n'avais que les vêtements que je portais. Dans ma fuite, j'avais abandonné la valise de carton à Boutaré. Je n'avais pu sauver que les vieilles chaussures à haut talon qui Makire m'avait données au lycée. J'y tenais tellement qu'imprudemment, je les avais mises pour être sûre de ne pas les perdre. Mon père m'avait confié son bien le plus précieux, le joyau de la maison, la bouteille de bénédictine. Le flacon royal, quelque peu déchu, nous servirait de groupe pendant le voyage. Antoine nous accompagna jusqu'au bout du champ. Et sous une pluie battante, nous nous sommes enfoncés dans la nuit. La pluie nous favorisait plutôt. Il y avait peu de chances que les militaires d'Ogako se risquent à patrouiller sous un tel déluge. Frodoir n'hésitait pas. La brousse n'avait pas de secret pour lui. Autour de nous, c'était le tapage habituel de la savane, envolé d'oiseaux, miaulements, galopades. Une masse plus sombre que j'avais prise pour une colline se mit soudain à bouger. C'était un couple d'éléphants qui déambulaient majestueusement. Dépêchons-nous, répétait sans cesse Frodoir. Je boitillais aussi vite que je pouvais derrière mes deux compagnons. Le talon d'une de mes chaussures s'était brisé. On se frayait difficilement un chemin dans l'épaisseur des fourrés. Les épines me déchiraient les mains, le visage et les pieds. Le jour se levait. Le soleil perçait un instant entre les gros nuages. À perte de vue, il n'y avait que des épineux. Ça y est, dit Frodoir, vous y êtes. On est au Burundi. Continuez tout droit. Vous finirez bien par arriver à Kirundo. On s'est embrassés. Nous étions en larmes. Frodoir est revenu sur ses pas. Ce n'est pas son matelas qu'on l'a tué, c'est 20 ans plus tard.
There was nothing for us to do but leave. In Burundi, we could probably continue our studies and find work. And above all, my parents weren't quite sure how to say it, at least some of us had to survive to keep the memory alive so the family would go on somewhere else. We'd been chosen to survive. We were counting on Antoine to lead us to the border. He was working at the Karama Agricultural Institute as a gardener. He only came back to the house on Saturday evenings, riding his bicycle. That Saturday, we gathered around the jug of sorghum beer my mother always saved for her eldest son's return. Antoine told us he didn't know much about the bush. He always kept to the dirt roads on his bike. But his friend Frodoir, who I've already mentioned, he worked for the campaign to eradicate the tsetse fly, would make an ideal guide across the border into Burundi. Frodoir was like a brother to him, and he was sure he wouldn't refuse. And indeed, Froidois agreed at once. The day set for our departure came all too soon. The plan was to leave in the very middle of the night once we were sure all the neighbors were sound asleep, not because we were afraid of being reported, but because if the neighbors saw us leaving, they might want to come with us. There was no way to leave in a large group. We'd soon be spotted by the patrolling soldiers from Gako, and we had every reason to fear that those who stayed behind would face reprisals. So as soon as the neighbors were all in their houses, we closed the door and pretended to sleep. Froidual came along. My father said the rosary, walking around the banana grove behind the house, counting off the Hail Marys. My mother usually refused to join in these processions, but just this once she followed him. I believe I did too. The time came to leave. We had to be over the border before dawn. Froidual said we'd need to walk quickly. We certainly wouldn't be weighed down by luggage. In addition to his little canvas bag with his shirt and his pair of shorts, my brother André kept his two treasures pressed close to his chest, his diploma, carefully rolled into a plastic tube, and his cassette player. I myself had only the clothes on my back. I'd abandoned my cardboard suitcase while I was fleeing Butare. All I could save were the old high-heeled shoes Immaculé had given me at school. They meant so much to me that I'd foolishly run away in them to be sure they wouldn't be lost. My father entrusted me with his most precious possession, the jewel of the house, the bottle of Benedictine. The royal flask, somewhat fallen from its lofty rank, would be our canteen for the trip. Antoine accompanied us to the far end of the field, and then in the pouring rain, we set off into the night. The rain was actually a blessing. The soldiers from Gaka wouldn't want to be out patrolling in such a downpour. Froidual never hesitated. The bush had no secrets for him. Around us, we heard the usual clamor of the savanna, howls, birds taking flight, pounding hooves. A form darker than the darkness around us, a huge mass I'd taken for a hill, began to move all at once. It was a couple of elephants, majestically strolling along. "Hurry, hurry," Froidual said again and again. I limped along as quickly as I could behind my two companions. The heel of one of my shoes had broken. With great difficulty, we forced our way through the dense thickets. The thorns tore my hands, face, and feet. Day was breaking. For a moment, the sun broke through the enormous clouds. As far as the eye could see, there was nothing but brambles. "This is it," said Froidual. "You're here. We're in Burundi. Keep going straight ahead and you'll end up in Kirundo." We embraced. We were all weeping. Froidual turned and went back the way he came. He wouldn't be killed that morning. He would be killed 20 years later. And finally, this last part tells a Scholastique's return to Rwanda many years after the genocide and her travel to the place, to the house where she grew up.
Le véhicule s'est arrêté à gauche de la piste, toujours saufouillé de buissons, de forêts. "Regarde," me dit Emmanuel, "tu ne reconnais pas? C'est chez Cosma, c'est chez Stéphania, c'est chez toi." Je regarde l'enchevêtrement des taillis, j'ai peine à m'en convaincre. "C'est chez moi." "Regarde," insiste Emmanuel, "les ciseaux de l'entrée." Oui, sur le bord de la piste, il y a bien quelques feuilles brunâtres aux épines noires, un peu racornies par la sécheresse. Emmanuel désigne un arbre étouffé par les ronces et les lianes. Voilà l'avocatier de Jeanne. Je me répète que je suis chez moi et je me raconte que pour me préserver, malgré ce que je m'avais dit mon frère, malgré ce que j'en savais, j'ai conservé comme un profond et secret espoir l'illusion que la désolation qui s'était abattue sur Gitagata avait chez moi épargné quelque chose, qu'un signe de par-delà la mort m'attendait. Mais bien sûr, il n'y avait rien ni personne. Et tout à coup, je me mets à haïr violemment cette végétation folle qui a si bien achevé le travail des assassins, qui a fait de chez moi cette brousse hostile. Je ne vais pas écouter les explications d'Emmanuel. Je ne vais pas répondre aux questions de mes fils. Je ne vais plus savoir où était la vieille maison ni la nouvelle. Je suis seule, seule une terre étrangère où personne ne m'attend pas. Je ferme les yeux et sur la scène des souvenirs se remettent en place les choses disparues. Et voici qu'un nouveau m'accueille à l'entrée, les grands caféiers chargés de cerises rouges. À leurs pieds, le paillage d'herbes sèches est un tapis sur lequel je marchais pieds nus. Le sentier est bordé de fleurs jaunes que j'en entretiens avec amour. Tout près de la maison, les bananiers profitent des jus de cuisseaux des haricots. Ce sont eux qui donnent les variétés les plus succulentes. Les kamaramasenge, les kingurubes. Ma mère nous a réservé les plus beaux régimes pour les vacances à notre retour. Devant la porte, un grand manioc sert devant. Ma mère m'attend sur le seuil. Elle a noué son plus beau pagne, celui qu'elle porte pour aller à la messe. Nous nous étreignons longuement ainsi que le veut la coutume, comme pour nous imprégner de la chaleur de nos corps. Elle me précède à l'intérieur et j'attends le clapetis de familier de la bière de sorgho qui fermente dans les grandes cruches. Nous pénétrons dans la pièce obscure. Ma mère m'entend un chalumeau. Je replonge dans le liquide frémissant. Je suis chez moi. Je me trace difficilement un passage parmi les ibiheiras et arbustes dont les tiges creuses servaient de chalumeaux. Ils ont tout envahi. Puis le fourré s'éclaircit, je traverse une étendue de terre rase. C'est notre ancien champ. La limite est toujours marquée par un numuturo dont les feuilles soignent les maladies de peau et qu'en débroussant, on prenait bien soin d'épargner. Je m'aperçois qu'à présent, je suis en sentier bien tracé et apparemment fréquenté. Voilà un champ de patates douces et des papayers. Et soudain, je me trouve à l'entrée d'un enclos qui est caché jusque-là ancré du terrain. La maison principale, rectangulaire, en terre battue, quelques cases plus petites, plus fristes, peut-être des étables ou l'habitation des enfants, la cour soigneusement balayée. Une femme plutôt avenante s'avance vers mon mari qui ouvre la marche. Mais me découvre soudain derrière, elle pousse un cri et s'enfuit. Je l'entends encore dans la bananerie sur le versant de la vallée de Gikombe qui répète en gémissant « Yebabawe, yebabawe, karabaye ». Ça devait arriver, ça devait arriver. Je m'aperçois qu'une fillette est accroupie dans l'étroite frange d'ombre au pied du mur de la grande case. Je lui demande qui est cette femme, pourquoi s'est-elle enfouie? Elle ne la connaît pas. C'est une voisine qui était venue en visite. Et puis, sans que je lui ai rien demandé, elle enchaîne. Tu sais, j'ai 12 ans. Pendant la guerre, j'étais trop petite, je n'ai rien vu. Elle s'interrompt. Un homme est apparu dans l'encadrement de la porte. Il s'avance vers moi. Je n'ai pas de peine à le reconnaître. C'est bien lui, le voisin, que ma mère avait invité à ma fête en 86. Je lui demande qui a habité à côté de chez lui. Il commence par sonner qu'il n'y a jamais eu personne. De l'autre côté de la route, oui, c'était habité chez Mounyaneza, mais à côté de chez moi, il n'y a jamais eu personne. Et Cosma, il n'a jamais entendu parler de Cosma. Puis il se reprend, oui, bien sûr, Cosma, mais quand ça s'est passé, il n'était pas là, il était au Congo. Écoute, lui dit Emmanuel, devant toi, c'est la fille de Cosma. Tu as quelque chose à lui dire. Il y a un long silence. Il hésite. Oui, c'est la fille de Cosma. Maintenant, je la vois. Je peux bien lui demander pardon. Je suis tellement bouleversée par ces mots que je suis comme paralysée. Il y a un long silence. Puis je cherche en vain une parole qui l'encouragerait à continuer. À me dire ce que je voudrais tant savoir depuis si longtemps. Mais déjà, il est trop tard. Il a repris son discours de négation. Je n'obtiendrai plus rien. Écoutez, je n'ai tué personne. Ils sont montés là-haut, à Rebero. Je n'ai tué personne. Je me souviens qu'ils sont partis vers 4 heures de l'après-midi. Je n'ai tué personne. Avez-vous entendu dire que j'ai tué quelqu'un? La famille est tombée à Rebero, ils étaient âgés. Personne n'est tombé ici. Moi, je ne connaissais pas ses enfants, sauf le jour où il a marié sa dernière fille. Je ne l'écoute plus. Que ce soit lui ou d'autres qui aient tué mes parents ou participé au meurtre, je ne le saurai jamais. Mais je m'obstine. Je ne veux pas repartir sans enseigne. C'est comme si j'avais à rendre compte que je suis encore là vivante. Et j'ai rempli la mission que 30 ans auparavant m'avaient confiée mes parents. Vivre au nom de tous, moi qui n'avais eu d'autre choix que d'être une bonne élève catholique, je me mets à espérer que l'esprit des morts, le Muzimu, va se manifester dans la broussaille et les vestiges de la bananerie et me donner sa réponse. Dans l'épaisseur du buisson où je me suis enfoncée, il me semble reconnaître le lieu d'éveillé, le foyer avec ses trois pierres au milieu de la grande coupelle d'argile, Bombiro, qu'avait modéré ma mère. Mon père est là, qui lit sa Bible à la lumière de la lampe et tempête. Près du foyer, nous sommes toutes les trois, Jeanne, Julienne et moi, serrés autour de maman à écouter ses contes. Et en effet, sous les branchages entremêlés, il y a un tas de pierres et de gravats. Comme poussé par une force inconnue, j'en écarte quelques cailloux. Et d'entre les pierres, surgit un serpent noir qui se faufile et disparaît dans les hautes herbes. Et moi qui ai une horreur panique des serpents, je m'étonne de ne pas crier, de ne pas m'enfouir à toutes jambes. Il me semble que fasciné, je ne peux détacher mon regard de repris du serpent qui s'offrait silencieusement un chemin entre les branchages desséchés. Tandis que je me dirige vers le véhicule, ma pensée revient sans cesse sur le serpent. Étrangement, c'est comme si son image me rassurait et m'apportait une sensation d'apaisement. Ce n'est pas le serpent mortel, levé dans la bananerie. Ce n'est pas celui dont les Hutus nous crachaient le nom en injure. Ce n'est pas non plus le serpent de la Bible de mon père, celui qu'on nous montrait à l'église, le serpent qui s'enroulait à la branche de l'arbre du paradis. Ce serpent, c'est celui que connaissait ma mère, elle qui savait tant de choses que la parole de précieux des missionnaires ne lui permettait pas de transmettre, mais qui parfois, au détour d'une phrase ou d'un geste, et c'est à moi souvent qu'elle aimait s'adresser, révélait tout un monde enfoui sous les leçons du catéchisme. Avant, disait-elle, avant l'arrivée des Blancs, il y avait dans chaque enclos un serpent familier et on le respectait car lui seul connaissait le chemin qui mène au pays des esprits des morts. Et sa présence était pour nous le signe de leur bienveillance. Je voudrais tant croire que ce serpent était bien le signe envoyé par tous ceux qui ont péri, qu'il me disait que je n'avais pas trahi les miens, que c'était bien pour eux que j'avais dû suivre le long des tours de l'exil, que j'étais revenu à leur appel pour recevoir en dépôt la mémoire de leur souffrance et de leur mort. Oui, je suis bien celle qu'on appelait toujours de son nom rwandais, celui que m'avait donné mon père, Mukasonga, mais désormais je garde à moi. Et comme faisant partie du plus intime de moi-même, les débris de vie, les noms de ceux qui agitouaient, agitagata, akiora, restèrent sans sépulture. Les assassins ont voulu effacer jusqu'à leur mémoire, mais dans le cahier des courriers qui ne me quittent plus, je consigne les noms. Je n'ai pour les miens et tous ceux qui sont tombés à Nyamata que ce tombeau de papier.
The truck has stopped. To the left of the road, still the same tangle of bushes, of thickets. Look, Emmanuel says to me, don't you recognize it? That's Cosmos Place and Stefania's. That's where you lived. I look at the tangled mass of brush. I have a hard time convincing myself. This is where I lived. Look, Emmanuel goes on, there are the sisal plants at the entrance. Yes, at the edge of the road, there are indeed a few round leaves with black spines, slightly withered by the dry weather. Emmanuel points to a tree smothered by brambles and vines. There's Jean's avocado tree. This is my home, I tell myself over and over, and I realize that to protect myself, despite everything my brother had told me, everything I knew, I'd clung to the illusion, like a deep secret hope, that the ruination of Gita Gata had spared something in the place where I once lived, that some sign was awaiting me from beyond death's realm. But of course, there was no one and nothing. And suddenly I began to violently hate the untamed vegetation that had so efficiently finished the murderer's work, that had turned my home into this inhospitable patch of brush. I don't want to listen to Emmanuel's explanations. I don't want to answer my son's questions. I don't want to know where the old house was or the new one. I'm alone in a foreign land where no one is waiting for me. I close my eyes, and on memory's stage, all the vanished things reappear and take their place. Here are the big coffee plants covered with red berries greeting me at the entrance again. I love walking on the carpet of dried grass mulch all around them. The path is lined with yellow flowers, lovingly tended by Jean. Just by the house, the banana trees grow strong on the bean's cooking liquid. They bear the most succulent varieties, the Kamamaras Masenge, the Ikingurube. My mother has saved up the nicest bunches, waiting for vacation to come when we'll all be home again. A tall cassava tree serves as an awning before the front door. My mother is waiting for me on the threshold. She's tied on her finest pagne, the one she wears for mass. We give each other a long embrace, as custom dictates, and as if to fill each other with the warmth of our bodies. She leads me inside, and I hear the familiar bubbling of the sorghum beer fermenting in the big jugs. We walk into the dark room. My mother hands me a straw. I thrust it into the sparkling liquid. I'm home. It's not easy, but I find a way through the ibe heha heha, those bushes whose hollow stems we use as straws. They've taken everything over. Then the thicket turns less dense. I cross a patch of bare land. This is our old field. Its edge is still marked by an umukuro, whose leaves are good for skin diseases. We always took great care to spare them when we were clearing brush. I realize that I'm following a very visible path, evidently still used. I even come across a field of sweet potatoes and papaya plants. And suddenly I find myself at the entry of an enclosure, hidden up to now by a hollow in the terrain. The main house, rectangular, made of pounded earth, and then a few smaller huts, cruder, perhaps stables or children's shacks, the yard carefully swept. A friendly looking woman comes toward my husband, who's walking ahead, but when she catches sight of me behind him, she lets out a cry and runs off. I can still hear her in the banana grove on the slope of the Gikombe Valley, wailing again and again, Yebabawe, Yebabawe, Karabai. It had to happen, it had to happen. I see a little girl crouching in the narrow band of shadow at the foot of the big hut's wall. I ask her, who is that woman? Why did she run away? She doesn't know her. She's a neighbor who'd come calling. And then, without my having asked her anything, she goes on. You know, I'm 12 years old. I was too little during the war. I didn't see anything. She breaks off there. A man has appeared in the doorway, and now he's coming toward us. I recognize him at once. Yes, that's him, the neighbor my mother invited to my party in 1986. I ask him who used to live next door. No one, he first insists. On the other side of the road, yes, there were people there. That was Munyaneza's house. But no one ever lives next door to me. What about Cosma? He's never heard of Cosma. Then he corrects himself. Oh, yes, of course, Cosma. But when that happened, he wasn't there. He was in the Congo. Listen, Emmanuel says to him, this is Cosma's daughter in front of you. Do you have anything to say to her? A long silence. He hesitates. Yes, that's Cosma's daughter. Now that I see her, I can certainly ask her for her forgiveness. I stand glued to the spot, half paralyzed, stunned by these words. Another long silence, and then I search in vain for some way of encouraging him to go on, to tell me what I've so long wanted to know, but it's already too late. He's gone back to his denial, so I'll get nothing more out of him. Listen, I never killed anyone. They went up there to Ribeiro. I didn't kill anyone. It was around 4 in the afternoon when they left. I remember, I didn't kill anyone. Have you ever heard anyone say I did? The family died in Ribeiro. They were old. No one died here. I never met his children, except for that day he married off his last daughter. I'm no longer listening. Was it him who murdered my parents, who'd at least played a part? Was it someone else? I'll never know. But I don't give up. I don't want to leave without some sort of sign. I feel like I have to show I'm still here, still alive. Have I carried out the mission my parents entrusted me with 30 years before? To live in the name of all the others. I, who had no choice but to be a good Catholic schoolgirl, I began to hope that the spirit of the dead, the umuzimu, will appear in the brush, in what's left of the banana grove, and give me an answer. Here in the midst of the thicket, I believe I can make out the spot where we gathered in the evening, the hearth with its three stones set in the wide flat clay dish, the urubumbiro, shaped by my mother. My father is there reading his Bible by the light of the hurricane lantern. Near the hearth, the three of us, Jean, Julien, and I, are pressed in around Mama, listening to her stories, and indeed, under the intertwining branches, I find a little pile of gravel and stones. As if driven by an unknown force, I sweep away a few pebbles. A black snake slithers out from the stones, then disappears into the tall grass. And I, who am terrified of snakes, I find myself not crying out, not fleeing as fast as my legs will carry me. Fascinated, my eyes stay glued to the serpent's coils as it makes its silent way among the dried branches. I walk to the pickup, my thoughts endlessly going back to the snake. Strangely, the sight of it seems to have comforted me and brought me a feeling of peace. This isn't the deadly snake coiled in the banana grove. It isn't the snake whose name the Hutu spat at us as an insult. Nor is it the serpent in my father's Bible, the one they showed us in church, wrapped around the branch of the tree in paradise. This is the snake my mother knew all about, she who knew so many things that the missionary's oppressive teachings forbade her to pass on, but that sometimes, poking out through a sentence or a gesture, often addressed to me, revealed a whole world hidden beneath the lessons of the catechism. Before, she would say, before the white people came, every enclosure had its own familiar snake, and it was respected because it alone knew the way to the land of the spirits of the dead. And when we saw it, we thought it was a sign of their good wishes. I would so like to think that this snake was a sign sent by all those who perished, that they were telling me I hadn't betrayed my family, that I'd had to follow the long detour of exile for their sake, that I'd come back to answer their call and shoulder the memory of their sufferings and their deaths. Yes, I am indeed the one they called by her Rwandan name, the one given me by my father, Mukasonga. But now, deep inside, like the most precious part of me, I hold what's left of the lives and the names of all those in Gitwe and Gitagata and Kiowa, who will never be properly buried. The murderers tried to erase everything they were, even any memory of their existence. But in the schoolchild's notebook that I am now never without, I write down their names. I have nothing left of my family and all the others who died in Yamada but that paper grave. Thank you very much. I believe the next reading is coming now.
I talked to Hisham on Friday afternoon to check on certain biographical details that I'm now not going to bore you with. But when I was finished, he had a question for me. "So, Peter," he said, "what do you think I should read at the Y?" Well, I'm a writer too, and I recognize the enormity of this superficially simple question. For however he decides to answer it, the choice will be in some way wrong. Of course, that's true of all books and all readings, but it's particularly true of this immensely moving, layered, vivid, tragic, noble story of love and loss. Because there is such pain at its core, a brief sample from the writer runs the risk of misdescribing the complex wonder he has made. Perhaps you already know. It's a story of a boy whose father is kidnapped by Gaddafi and then entombed in a dark concrete hole where he will not see the sun for years on end. It's the story of his own son's relentless search in which the terror of not knowing his father's fate is sometimes broken by smuggled notes, but of course, the smuggled letters are followed by silence, and hope itself is made an instrument of torture. This is essential information, and it will be quite right for the author to let you know this when he chooses whatever it is he's going to read tonight. With this, whatever it is, you will go away thinking you know the flavour of the book ahead of you. But what is really remarkable about The Return is that it is a tapestry, and it has many. And if it has many dark corners, it also has yellow sunlight and a sea in which you'll read this. The grown-up son swims as his father taught him, far out into the Mediterranean, until he can no longer see the land. And there he will spin himself around until he has lost direction, and you, the reader, will be somewhere very strange and very beautiful. And then you will find yourself in England, with the earth folding you in, and pale, ballied clouds interlaced above the lanes. And then you will understand that you're actually in the midst of a gripping history of Libya and the Italian occupation. And there'll be food you want to eat. And it will become quickly obvious that the author has an amazing visual intelligence, so pronounced that you won't be surprised when I tell you that Hisham, having spent 30 minutes in front of a particular Canaletto painting, is then likely to take a short stroll and then come back and have another look. So this is the life of a deeply cultured man, and it is a narrative so gracefully structured that when I tell you he began his working life as an architect, you will say, of course he did. The Return is a visceral experience. Indeed, it made me think of my single visit to Chile just after Pinochet was arrested. And I was part of a touring, performing delegation of Chilean, South African and Australian writers. And the thing I most remember was how the South Africans, in recalling their own sufferings at the hands of torturers, or when listening to the sufferings of our Chilean hosts, remained dry-eyed, while I, who had been spared the cruelties of dictators, spent all day long trying not to cry. I thought of this because in the midst of silently reading The Return, I was surprised to discover my cheeks awash with tears. I had never cried when reading, not once in all my life, and I didn't know I was weeping now until I touched my face. Later, talking to Hisham, I told him about my tears and asked him about his. Yes, he said, I see. But Peter, one fears if one began to cry, one would never stop. So Hisham has written a great book, one that will still be read when we're all dead and buried. It's our honour to hear him read it now. Please welcome him. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you for coming. I thank also the organizers, indeed everyone involved in the arrangements for this evening. I would particularly like to thank Peter Carey for his introduction. God, those words coming from an author I admire and respect will remain with me. I would also like to join those who spoke before this evening in welcoming you all, particularly on a night like this, where much, it seems, hangs in the balance. Perhaps then it is appropriate in a time when public discourse has shrunk so much that it sometimes resembles a space as confining as a coffin, that we should be focused tonight out of all nights on literature. I'll be reading from The Return, which really marks a break of habit for me, in that unlike previous books, it's, or at least it pertains to be true. I say pertains because the imagination too co-remembers, it seems, This book has been running in my veins for a long time. What triggered it was a trip I made back to my native country, Libya, in 2012, shortly after the fall of the dictatorship. I had left the country with my family in 1979. It had not been my choice. And for the following 33 years, I could not return. In that time, I had lost my father, who was kidnapped and forcibly returned to Libya. He was imprisoned, tortured, and then made to disappear. I have spent most of my adult life searching for him, living with his vague and inconclusive absence. And once it was possible to go to Libya after the fall of Gaddafi, I returned to see the places and people I loved and learned to live without, but also to look for my father. Back home in London and over the 3 months that followed, I could not write a word. This had never happened before. I wondered if I had somehow reached the end of my writing life. It was in such a state of mind that I visited an old friend who lives in the Piedmont. For some reason, I brought with me those Libyan diaries. One afternoon, I started very slowly, picking out the first line as though it were a thread, and using it to begin. In fact, the first couple of lines of the book were lifted straight off that diary. But just as how a person cannot be defined alone by their outer form, books too, I believe, cannot be defined or summarized by their genre or their initial motivation. My book is about that return, of course, about my complex relationship to Libya, its history and present, my family, my search for my father, but it is also about other things that are, in my view, more essential. My book's inner world deals with questions that have preoccupied me, and I think have concerned literature since time immemorial, the relationship between the past and present, how history weighs on us, how we ought to respond to all that has happened before, the nature of belonging to anything or anyone, the mysterious distance that exists between what we feel and how we act, and the relationship between art and life. After my conversation with Peter earlier today, or was it yesterday? It was yesterday. I decided to keep it simple, Peter, and just read from the beginning. Here's the lines that I picked out of the diary. Early morning, March 2012. My mother, my wife Diana, and I were sitting in a row of seats that were bolted to the tiled floor of a lounge in Cairo International Airport. Flight 835 for Benghazi, a voice announced, was due to depart on time. Every now and then, my mother glanced anxiously at me. Diana, too, seemed concerned. She placed a hand on my arm and smiled. I should get up and walk around, I told myself. But my body remained rigid. I had never felt more capable of stillness. The terminal was nearly empty. There was only one man sitting opposite us. He was overweight, weary-looking, possibly in his mid-50s. There was something in the way he sat, his locked hands on the lap, the left tilt of the torso, that signaled resignation. Was he Egyptian or Libyan? Was he on a visit to the neighboring country or going home after the revolution? Had he been for or against Gaddafi? Perhaps he was one of those undecided ones who held their reservations close to their chests. The voice of the announcer returned. It was time to board. I found myself standing at the front of the queue, Diana beside me. She had, on more than one occasion, taken me to the town where she was born in Northern California. I know the plants and the color of the light and the distances where she grew up. Now I was finally taking her to my land. She had packed the Hasselblad and the Leica, her two favorite cameras, and 100 rolls of film. Diana works with great fidelity. Once she gets hold of a thread, she will follow it until the end. Knowing this excited and worried me. I'm reluctant to give Libya any more than it has already taken. Mother was pacing by the windows that looked onto the runway, speaking on her mobile phone. People, mostly men, began to fill the terminal. Diana and I were now standing at the head of a long line. It bent behind us like a river. I pretended I had forgotten something and pulled her to one side. Returning after all these years was a bad idea, I suddenly thought. My family had left in 1979, 33 years earlier. This was the chasm that divided the man from the eight-year-old boy I was then. The plane was going to cross that gulf. Surely such journeys were reckless. This could rob me of a skill that I have worked hard to cultivate, how to live away from places and people I love. Joseph Brodsky was right. So were Nabokov and Conrad. They were artists who never returned. Each had tried, in his own way, to cure himself of his country. What you have left behind has dissolved. Return, and you will face the absence or the defacement of what you treasured. But Dmitri Shostakovich and Boris Pasternak and Naguib Mahfouz were also right. Never leave the homeland. Leave, and your connections to the source will be severed. You will be like a dead trunk, hard and hollow. What do you do when you cannot leave and cannot return? Back in October 2011, I had considered never returning to Libya. I was in New York City, walking up Broadway, the air cold and swift. When the proposition presented itself, it seemed immaculate, a thought my mind had manufactured independently. As in youthful moments of drunkenness, I felt bold and invincible. I had gone to New York the previous month at the invitation of Barnard College to lecture on novels about exile and estrangement, but I had an older connection to the city. My parents had moved to Manhattan in the spring of 1970, when my father was appointed first secretary in the Libyan mission to the United Nations. I was born that autumn. 3 years later, in 1973, we returned to Tripoli. In the years since, I had visited New York maybe 4 or 5 times, and always briefly. So although I had just returned to the city of my birth, it was a place I hardly knew. In the 36 years since we left Libya, my family and I had built associations with several surrogate cities. Nairobi, where we went on our escape from Libya in 1979, and have continued to visit ever since. Cairo, where we settled the following year into indefinite exile. Rome, a vacation spot for us. London, where I went at the age of 15 for my studies and where for 29 years I have been doggedly trying to make a life for myself. Paris, where, fatigued and annoyed by London, I moved in my early 30s, vowing never to return to England, only to find myself back 2 years later. In all these cities, I had pictured myself one day calm and living in that faraway island, Manhattan, where I was born. I could imagine a new acquaintance asking me, perhaps at a dinner party or in a cafe or in changing rooms after a long swim, that old tiresome question, where are you from? And I, unfazed and free of the usual agitation, would casually reply, New York. In these fantasies, I saw myself taking pleasure from the fact that such a statement would be both true and false, like a magic trick. That I should move to Manhattan in my 40th year as Libya was ripping itself apart, and for this to take place on the 1st of September, the day when, back in 1969, a young captain named Muammar Gaddafi deposed King Idris and many of the significant features of my life, where I live, the language in which I write, the language I am using now to write this, were set in motion. All this made it difficult to escape the idea that there was some kind of divine will at work. In any political history of Libya, the 1980s represent a particularly lurid chapter. Opponents of the regime were hanged in public squares and sports arenas. Dissidents who fled the country were pursued, some kidnapped or assassinated. The 80s were also the first time that Libya had an armed and determined resistance to the dictatorship. My father was one of the opposition's most prominent figures. The organization he belonged to had training camps in Chad, south of the Libyan border, and several underground cells inside the country. Father's career in the army, his short tenure as a diplomat, and the private means he had managed to procure in the mid-1970s, when he became a successful businessman, importing products as diverse as Mitsubishi vehicles and Converse sports shoes to the Middle East, made him a dangerous enemy. The dictatorship had tried to buy him off. It had tried to scare him. I remember sitting beside him one afternoon in our flat in Cairo when I was 10 or 11, the weight of his arm on my shoulders. In the chair opposite sat one of the men I called uncle, men who, I somehow knew, were his allies or followers. The word compromise was spoken, and Father responded, "I won't negotiate, not with criminals." Whenever we were in Europe, he carried a gun. Before getting into the car, he would ask us to stand well away. He would go down on his knees and look under the chassis, cup his hands and peek through the windows for any sign of wiring. Men like him had been shot in train stations and cafes, their cars blown up. During the 1980s, when I was still in Cairo, I had read in the newspaper about the death of a renowned Libyan economist. He was stepping off a train at Stazioni Termini in Rome when a stranger pressed a pistol to his chest and pulled the trigger. The photograph printed beside the article had the figure of the deceased covered in newspaper sheets, presumably from that day's paper, which stopped at his ankles, leaving his polished leather shoes pointing up. Another time, there was a report of a Libyan student shot in Greece. He was sitting on the terrace of a cafe on Monastiriki Square in Athens. A scooter stopped, and the man sitting behind the driver pointed a gun at the student and fired several times. A Libyan BBC World Service newsreader was killed in London. In April 1984, a demonstration took place in front of the Libyan embassy in St. James's Square in London. One of the embassy staff pulled up a sash window on the first floor, held out a machine gun, and sprayed the crowd. A policewoman, Yvonne Fletcher, was killed, and 11 Libyan demonstrators were wounded, some of them critically. It was out of the question for Father to travel on his real passport. He used false documents with pseudonyms. In Egypt, we felt safe, but in March 1990, Father was kidnapped from our Cairo flat by the Egyptian secret police and delivered to Gaddafi. He was taken to Abu Slim prison in Tripoli, which was known as the last stop, the place where the regime sent those it wanted to forget. In the mid-1990s, several people risked their lives to smuggle three of my father's letters to my family. In one of them, Father writes, "The cruelty of this place far exceeds all of what we have read of the fortress prison of Bastille. The cruelty is in everything, but I remain stronger than their tactics of oppression. My forehead does not know how to bow." In another letter, there is this sentence: "At times, a whole year will pass by without seeing the sun or being let out of the cell." In calm, precise, and at times ironic, prose, he demonstrated astonishing commitment to patience. And now, a description of this noble palace. The cell is a concrete box. Walls are made of prefabricated slabs. There is a steel door through which no air passes. A window that is 3.5 meters above the ground. As for the furniture, it is in the style of Louis XVI. An old mattress worn out by many previous prisoners, torn in several places. The world here is empty. From these letters and from prisoner testimonies that I've been able to gather with the help of Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, and the Swiss NGO Trial, we know that Father was in Abu Slim at least from March 1990 to April 1996, when he was moved from his cell and either taken to another secret wing in the same prison, moved to another prison, or executed. In late August 2011, Tripoli fell, and revolutionaries took control of Abu Slim. They broke down the cell doors, and eventually all the men crammed inside those concrete boxes wandered out into the sunlight. I was at home in London. I spent that day on the telephone with one of the men hammering away at the steel doors of the cell, of the prison cells. "Wait, wait," he would shout, and I would hear his sledgehammer hitting steel. Not the sound of a bell in the open, but one buried deep, like a recalled memory ringing, "I want to be there, and I don't want to be there." Countless voices were shouting now. He handed the hammer to another man. I listened to him pant, purpose and victory in every breath. "I want to be there, and I don't want to be there." They came to a cell in the basement, the last one remaining. Lots of shouting now. People vying to lend a hand. I heard the man call out, "What? Inside?" There was confusion. Then I heard him shout, "Are you sure?" He got back on the phone and said they thought the cell contained an important person from Ejdebia, my father's hometown, who had been in solitary confinement for many years. I could not speak. I wanted to be there, and I wanted to be there. "Stay with me," the man on the telephone said. Every few seconds, he would repeat, "Stay with me." Whether it took 10 minutes or an hour, I cannot say. When they eventually broke down the door, they found an old blind man in a windowless room. His skin had not seen the sun in years. When they asked him his name, he said he did not know. What family was he from? He did not know. How long had he been there? He had, apparently, lost his memory. He had one possession, a photograph of my father. Why? Who was he to Father? The prisoner did not know. And although he could not remember anything, he was happy to be free. That was the word the man on the telephone used, happy. I wanted to ask about the picture. Was it a recent one or an old one? Was it pinned to the wall, kept under the pillow, or did they find it on the floor beside the man's bed? Was there a bed? Did the prisoner have a bed? I asked none of these questions. And when the man said, "I'm sorry," I thanked him and hung up. Now, so as not to disappoint Peter, I'm going to read something not from the beginning. Very, very short. From the middle, I take your hands and pull you to the middle of the book. Not knowing when my father ceased to exist has further complicated the boundary between life and death. But this can only partly explain why, for the longest time, even before my father's disappearance, the commonplace occurrence of being able to point to a calendar and say it was on that exact day that a particular person's life ended has always seemed inaccurate. Perhaps we should be with the bereaved, cover our ears and insist, no, he is not dead. Perhaps that is not only a denial of terrible news, but also a momentary recognition of a truth, one that passes and is buried along with the deceased. Disbelief is the right instinct, for how can the dead really be dead? I think this because absence has never seemed empty or passive, but rather a busy place, vocal and insistent. As Aristotle writes, the theory that the void exists involves the existence of place, for one would define void as place bereft of body. He says nothing of time here, and time is surely part of it all, of how we try to accommodate the absence. Perhaps this is why, in countless cultures, people in mourning rock or sway from side to side, not only to recall infancy and the mother's heartbeat, but to keep time. Only time can hope to fill the void. The body of my father is gone, but his place is here and occupied by something that cannot be called memory. It is alive and current. How could the complexities of being, the mechanics of our anatomy, the intelligence of our biology, and the endless firmament of our interiority, the thoughts and questions and yearnings and hopes and hunger and desire and the thousand and one contradictions that inhabit us at any given moment ever have an ending that could be marked by a date on the calendar? Hasn't it always seemed that way? Haven't I always detected the confusion of funerals, the uncertainty of cemeteries, the bewilderment of a headstone? Perhaps memorials and all the sacred and secular rituals of mourning across our human history are but failed gestures. The dead live with us. Grief is not a whodunit story or a puzzle to solve, but an active and vibrant enterprise. It is hard, honest work. It can break your back. It is part of one's initiation into death, and I don't know why, I have no way of justifying it. It is a hopeful part of that. What is extraordinary is that, given everything that has happened, the natural alignment of the heart remains towards the light. It is in that direction that there is the least resistance. I have never understood this, not intellectually anyway, but it is somehow in the body, in the physical knowledge of the eternity of each moment, in the expansive nature of time and space, that declarative statements such as, he is dead, are not precise. My father is both dead and alive. I do not have a grammar for him. He is in the past, present, and future. Even if I had held his hand and felt it slacken as he exhaled his last breath, I would still, I believe, every time I refer to him, pause to search for the right tense. I suspect many men who have buried their fathers feel the same. I'm no different. I live, as we all live, in the aftermath. Thank you.
Thank you, Hisham. Scholastique is coming. We're going to do a few audience questions. We'll bring the lights up in a second. And then the authors will sign books. Questions? Anyone? Yes. I'll repeat it. You would project, though. Mukasonga.
Hisham Matar.
Did everyone hear that? Maybe you could sum it up.
Is my initial purpose... Yes, I was just repeating it so everybody can hear it, but was my initial purpose for a cathartic outcome somehow by writing the book? No, it certainly wasn't. And that for me would be treachery, because... you could read that in a book when a book is in service of the writer's ambition or cause, or including a very private one such as feeling better. So no, it wasn't for that. It was really written out of curiosity. I'm just genuinely curious about these things that have occupied me for a long time. And I'm curious about them in a very specific, I'm curious in their specificity, but also I think the source of my real enthusiasm is how I see a lot of this in other people and other things. In other words, it doesn't really just seem about me. And I worried about that in the beginning, because notwithstanding the evidence, I'm a private man, writing a memoir, there you go. But, I worried about occupying that space and speaking so candidly about things that are very close to me. But the surprise was that as the book instigated its own attitudes, its own appetites, it was clear to me that it was really... paradoxically not really about me. So the strange thing about this book and writing it for me was that, notwithstanding the difficult material, and the difficulty to sustain that psychological space, that emotional psychological space for the 3 years it took to write it, it was also very thrilling because the modes of the book, the different tones and registers that it invited were fantastically exciting for the writer to work with. So it always seemed, it seemed like a horse that has appetites that are just beyond my own abilities, And I really do think that books are our fate. There are things that you don't really, of course you have a lot of choices when you're writing, but your choices are far more limited than you think. And so the character of the book that you're working on seems to me your fate, really. And so I had this, these two things, the difficulty of the personal material and also the excitement of the artist, So that was not cathartic, but it had the pleasure that one would get from any sort of work, I suspect.
Yes.
C'est aussi lié à la politique et aux droits de l'homme. Pourriez-vous parler de ces thèmes? Que se passe-t-il quand on parle d'histoires très personnelles qui sont aussi liées à ces grandes questions de politique et de droits de l'homme?
Scholastique? Let me repeat the question. The woman is asking, these are very personal stories, and yet they deal with great political themes as well. And if they would talk more about how the personal and the political are connected.
Moi, je pense que de toutes les façons, c'est très difficile de trouver, de penser. On ne peut que s'indigner.
I think it's very difficult to think you can only be outraged.
C'est comme quelque part, mais ce n'est pas une. Peut-être que ce n'est pas adapté, mais. Il y a quelque part dans les premiers, quand ça vous arrive, parce que c'est vrai que ce sont des livres tout à fait similaires.
It's true that when this happens to you, because there are these commonalities between our two books.
C'est comme un destin, mais c'est pas acceptable.
It is like a destiny, but it's not acceptable.
Parce que c'est un destin qui ne devait pas, où il y aurait pu un moyen de contourner les choses avant que ça fasse des dégâts extrêmes.
Because it's a destiny where things could have been avoided before are these extreme outcomes.
L'indignation, c'est de constater que il y a le lieu où les choses où le mal se fait.
Indignation, outrage is to be aware that you have this location where things happened, where evil was done.
Le lieu étant le pays où se passe les dégâts.
The location being the country where these things happened.
Mais ces pays ne sont pas isolés du monde extérieur.
But these countries are not isolated from the rest of the world.
Et l'indignation, c'est de voir qu'on laisse les dictateurs aller jusqu'au bout de leur folie.
The indignation is to see that these dictators are allowed to go all the way to the end of their insanity.
Alors, il y a des malfaiteurs directs. À ce qui concerne le Rwanda, les génocidaires directs.
So as far as you have these direct criminals, as far as Rwanda is concerned, you have these people who directly committed the genocide.
Mais la question là qui reste posée et qui est beaucoup plus grave.
But the issue that it remains and that is much more serious.
C'est la responsabilité de la communauté internationale qui laisse faire.
Is the issue of the international community that allows for such things to happen.
Pour autant, on ne peut pas être fataliste.
You can't be a fatalist, nonetheless.
Il y a toujours, et c'est la meilleure des choses, je pense, hein, donc il y a toujours moyen de croire en l'homme, parce qu'autrement, on sombrerait dans la folie et on aurait perdu. L'écriture n'aurait pas fait le travail qu'elle a fait, parce que l'écriture est là justement pour le réparer.
We can at least believe in human beings, because otherwise you would just sink into insanity and despair. And thankfully, writing is there, and it has this redemptive or this ability to repair, to fix things.
Je crois que le mot, ce n'est pas un mot simple comme ça, c'est un mot qui a une grande place. Il faut, quand on a vécu une telle souffrance,
when you've experienced such a suffering,
je pense qu'en face, on met toujours le mot, ce mot que je vais dire, c'est d'y croire et de dire plus jamais ça.
You always use this word and you have to believe in it, this word being never again.
Well, your question makes me think about how it seems to me like one of the questions that is hovering over us from the beginning of time is, will we succeed to say anything more than, will language ever be able to express something greater than what silences express, right? And this in Libya is a very, or for a Libyan writer, I think is, although I have to admit, when I write, I don't think of these things. I mean, I don't think of myself as a Libyan writer. I don't think of myself as a writer. I don't think of any of these things when I'm writing. But I remember with my first book, this was very, very much, it weighed on me, the sense that whatever you do as a Libyan writer, you're writing in the place of silence. You're writing in the place of other people that haven't been able to write. And also, not only in that sense, but you're also disrupting. Because the more silence there is, whatever you offer is going to be required to express lots of other things. And it's a contested space, no? And so it seemed to me a very interesting position to be in, because you have to somehow remain as free and as independent as possible, and as true to your curiosities as possible. It was for me quite an interesting question growing up in a house like what in the Middle East we call a political home, you know, filled with dissidents and people, you know, having very robust, active, enthusiastic conversations about politics, and there were men of action, right? And I'm not a man of action. I'm an artist. When I look at an obstacle, my first thought isn't how do I break the obstacle. It's why is the obstacle there? How did the obstacle come to be there? What does the obstacle want? You know. So my approach is an approach of curiosity, and it seemed incredibly important in that sort of situation to create as much freedom around me for myself. I mean, no one else was going to do it. No one else can do it for any writer from anywhere except for yourself, to give yourself those permissions, to refuse for your work to be employed even by yourself, no matter how legitimate the your grievance. This was for me a very complex space. So to help me navigate it, I used to ask myself a mischievous question, which is, who is dominated more by the reality of the dictatorship? Those who work night and day to undermine it, or those who work night and day to prop it up? Both seem to be working within the lexicon of that reality. And I respect this. I mean, I respect men of action, men and women of action. I respect political work. It's not that I look down on it for a minute. Many great people who have, brave people who have given up everything for this. But it's important to know what my responsibilities are to the page, and that I must be faithful to my work just as they are faithful to theirs.
Scholastique, would you say something of the reception of your work in Rwanda?
Mon travail, donc, quand j'ai écrit, ce n'était pas que moi. Je ne me positionnais pas comme auteur individuel.
When I was writing,
je prêtais ma main à tous ceux qui ne pouvaient pas témoigner, sortir ce poison de leur corps.
When I was writing, I wasn't positioning myself as an individual writer. I was writing for everyone, for all the people who could not extirpate this poison from their bodies.
Et cette émission, je l'avais depuis même avant le génocide.
Mission had been mine even before the genocide.
Depuis le moment où la discrimination a éclaté, depuis les années 60.
Ever since discrimination became very apparent in the 1960s.
Où l'État, l'apartheid de Rwanda avait décrété que dans les écoles, il y avait le système de quota de 10% des Tutsis dans les écoles.
Where the Rwandan state declared at that time that, for instance, in the schools, they imposed this quota system where you would only have 10% of Tutsi students.
Et moi, comme je me trouvais dans la parmi les déportés de Nyamata, où on avait parqué que des Tutsis depuis les années 60.
And since I was among the deportees who were sent to Nyamata, where the Tutsis were sent in the 60s.
Dans cette région de déportés de Tutsis, il n'y avait même pas de quota de 10%.
In that specific region made up of deported Tutsis, that a quota of 10% didn't even exist.
Ça a été comme, même si je ne crois pas toujours au miracle, mais il y a des choses qui sont similaires qu'on ne peut pas nier. J'ai fait une des rares exceptions pour sortir de Nyamata et aller plus loin, faire les études.
And although I don't, I mean, although it's strange to use miracle, but I think there was something that stemmed from the miraculous because I was able to leave, to come out of Nyamata, and I was able to pursue studies.
Et le jour où j'ai fait partie de la liste de ce qui était admis à l'école secondaire après l'école primaire.
And when I was added to that list of people who were allowed to move on to middle school after primary school,
je savais que je devais représenter tous ceux qui n'avaient pas pu aller plus loin, tous ceux qui restaient dans les campagnes de Nyamata. Donc j'allais à l'école pour tous ces enfants qui n'ont pas pu avoir cette chance exceptionnelle.
So I knew then that I was going to school and I was going to be representing all those who were unable to leave Nyamata and that I had this exceptional opportunity, but I was also going to represent them.
Et d'ailleurs, j'étais portée par tous les habitants de Nyamata se cotisaient pour payer le minerval, donc c'est les frais scolaires s'appellent minerval en belge.
And actually, all the inhabitants of Nyamata, they put their resources together to help cover my school fees.
Alors, ce qui, pour revenir, pour répondre à la question, ça veut dire que quand j'ai écrit, ce n'était pas moi seule qui écrivais parce que j'étais tous ces enfants qui n'avaient pas pu avoir cette même chance. J'étais toutes ces pour ces femmes de la campagne qui n'ont pas eu accès à cette chance de pouvoir confier les souffrances à la feuille blanche. Donc, Inyenzi, ça a toujours été le livre de tous les Rwandais et a été accueilli en tant que tel.
So that comes back to when I started to write, it wasn't just me. I was writing for all these children who didn't have the chance that I had, for all these women from the countryside. I was able to lay down their suffering on the white page. So the book Cockroaches was a book of all of them.
Je cite ici Elie Wiesel.
I would like to quote Elie Wiesel.
Dans la nuit, il dit.
In the book The Night, he says.
Il faut pour le survivant, son devoir est simple.
A survivor's duty is a simple one.
Il faut déposer pour les morts autant pour les vivants, et surtout pour les générations futures.
You have to depose for the dead as well as for the living, and especially above all for future generations.
Nous n'avons pas droit de les priver de la mémoire commune.
We have no right to deprive them of common memory, communal memory.
Et c'était ça le sens d'Inyenzi qui est Cockroaches.
And that was the meaning of my book, Cockroaches.
Et c'est récit par les scolaires, les étudiants comme tel, c'est les livres.
And it's received that way by students and academics. It's considered as their book, and I, the translator, forgot to add. So therefore, because I was writing for all the children, all the women of my community, when the book appeared in Rwanda, it was very well received.
J'en ai écrit d'autres.
And I've written other books since.
Pas beaucoup, mais
not that many.
Même six, je crois.
Six, though.
Mais celui-là, Inyenzi ou les cafards, c'est le livre des Rwandais.
Le livre the book I've written six books since then, but that specific book Cockroaches is the book of all of us Rwandans.
Que ce soit des Hutus ou des Tutsis.
Whether they're Hutus or Tutsis.
Et d'ailleurs, ça n'existe plus depuis 1994, tout le monde est Rwandais.
And in fact, these categories no longer exist since 1994. Since then, everybody is Rwandan.
Et d'ailleurs, ça n'a jamais existé parce que ça n'y a jamais détenu au Rwanda.
And actually, in fact, they never ever existed because there is no ethnicities in Rwanda.
Parce qu'il ne peut pas y avoir détenu dans un pays où tout le monde parle la même langue, le Rwanda.
Because you can't have ethnicities in a country where everybody speaks the same language, Kinyarwandan.
Où tout le monde obéit à la même culture.
where everyone follows, obeys the same writing,
où tout le monde vit ensemble,
where everyone lives together,
et où tout le monde se marie ensemble,
and everyone marries one another.
Maybe a final question. Well, then we'll thank the authors and say good night. Thank you all for coming.